as we've gone through this series on worship and we sort of walked through worship services on Sunday, we saw that God has gathered us, much like we gather eggs. He's drawn us in. He's brought us into this place, and he has greeted us and welcomed us and blessed us, that we have acknowledged that we are a people in need and that we are not worthy of his presence. And so we are able to find forgiveness. We are able to find grace and renewed grace and renewed love in our worship. And so we are able to respond. And so this morning is, what is our response? And I want us to look at a passage in Exodus this morning. Exodus, actually, chapter 15. And so I invite you to turn with me to Exodus 15. We will have our prayer at the end of our message this morning. We're not going to forget about prayer, but we will do it later. And so Exodus 15, and this is the story of the time of worship, the song of Moses and Miriam after the Israelites crossed the Red Sea on dry land, after they were delivered out of slavery in Egypt. And so if you are able, please stand as we hear and listen to God speak to us through his word this morning. Exodus 15, beginning at verse 1, we'll read through verse 21. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. The horse and its rider he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior, and the Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he has hurled into the sea. The best of Pharaoh's officers are drowned in the Red Sea. The deep waters have covered them, and they have sunk to the depths like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, was majestic in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shattered the enemy. In the greatness of your majesty, you threw down those who opposed you. You unleashed your burning anger, and it consumed them like stubble. By the blast of your nostrils, the waters piled up. The surging waters stood firm like a wall. The deep waters congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy boasted, I will pursue. I will overtake them. I will divide the spoils. I will gorge myself on them. I will draw my sword, and my hand will destroy them. But you blew with your breath, and the sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Who among all the gods is like you, O Lord? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working your wonders? You stretched out your right hand, and the earth swallowed them. In your unfailing love, you will lead the people you have redeemed. In your strength, you will guide them to your holy dwelling. The nations will hear, and they will tremble in anguish. Anguish will grip the people of Philistia. The chiefs of Edom will be terrified. The leaders of Moab will be seized with trembling, and the people of Canaan will melt away. Terror and dread will fall upon them. By the power of your arm, they will all be as still as stone, until your people pass by, O Lord, until the people you brought pass by. You will bring them in and plant them on the mountain of your inheritance, the place, O Lord, you have made for your dwelling. The sanctuary of the Lord your hands established. The Lord will reign forever and ever. When Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen went into the sea, the Lord brought the waters of the sea back on them, but the Israelites walked through the sea on dry ground. Then Miriam, the prophetess, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women followed her with tambourines and dancing. Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. The horse and rider has been hurled into the sea." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Worship is a response to God's wonderful works in our life. And as we listen to this story and as we listen to what God tells us, the things that he has done, the things that he will continue to do, sometimes we hear them so often, we simply are no longer listening. It's sort of like in our life when someone you know tells you 100 times a certain thing, after about the fifth time you don't listen anymore. We call that selective listening, selective hearing. We hear what they're saying, but we're choosing not to listen to it. When we listen to God, when we hear what He has to say, we should be a people who worship and respond with gratitude and praise. When we do not respond with gratitude, when our response is not one of praise, we are like a rooster who never crows in the morning when the sun rises. They simply forget. How many of you know a rooster that doesn't crow in the morning? How many of you wish you had a rooster who did not crow in the morning? But the rooster crows to signal that the sun is rising, a new day has dawned, a new life, a new day has begun. For us as Christians, that should be our programmed response, to respond in praise to God. Now, when the children of Israel, when Moses and the children crossed the Red Sea on dry land, and when they saw God's marvelous works, they had just witnessed the 10 plagues over a period of time. They had witnessed the last plague where they had sprinkled the blood of the lamb, and they participated in this newly fashioned, designed feast gathering of God's people in each other's homes, and they prepared the food and they ate it exactly the way God told them to. They sprinkled the blood of the lamb that was killed on the doorpost, and then a dark and terrible night happened. The angel of death passed by everyone's house. And let me tell you, when the angel of death passed by their house, it wasn't as if they didn't notice anything. They could sense, they could feel the death. There was fear. Believe you me, there was fear. But then, when the angel of death passed by their house, when they could hear the wailing of other homes, of other places in the community, of the places where the angel of death had struck, there was joy, there was gratitude. It was the natural response because of what God had done, what they had witnessed. And now they had been delivered out of Egypt, crossing the Red Sea. The worship leader there on that day, as they began this spontaneous worship, the worship leader that day didn't have to say, "Okay, everybody, let's sing that song again with a little more emotion and velocity. Sing it like you mean it, people." They didn't have to have a praise and worship band playing a little louder so that it sounded like there was a lot of praise happening. They didn't have to have a praise band or a bunch of people singing because no one else was singing. No, they were all involved in this praise and worship. It was a response to what God had done in their life. G. Campbell Morgan tells this story. He said, there was a great English actor who was approached by an eminent preacher, and the preacher approached him and asked him, "I wish you would explain something to me." The actor said, "Well, what is it? Although I don't know if I can really explain anything that's of any help to a pastor, a preacher like you." The pastor said, "This is what it is. You are appearing before crowds every night. And every night you go before them and you present fiction, something that's not real. You're acting. And yet the people come in droves and they applaud you at the end of the show. But yet, on Sunday, I stand up before the people with everything that is true, that is unchangeable, that is life-giving. And my crowds are small. And there's no sense of appreciation afterwards. What's the difference?" And the actor responded, "That's simple." And this was his response: "I present fiction, but when I present fiction, I present it as though it were true. You present truth. But when you present it, you present it and it appears as if it's fiction. When we worship God, when we come and respond to what God is doing in our life, do we come as if that is real? As if that is real and true in our life? Or do we come responding as if, yeah, that's the story I tell, but it's a story? Do we really believe what God is doing in our life? Do we really believe that God is working in our life in every part, in every phase, and that without Him we would be nothing? Now, in order for us to respond to God's gathering, in order for us to respond to God's grace that He has shown to us, in order to respond to the Word that is spoken by God to us as He speaks to us in love, in order for us to respond in praise, the best way that we can respond is if we focus our attention on God. Our focus has to be on God and who He is and what He has done in our life. Our minds cannot be distracted. Now, I know that we all live busy lives, and we've had busy weeks, and sometimes we're thinking about trying to get ahead of the game for next week. And some of the things that we've been doing in our life have overlapped and fallen into our life for Sunday, the day of rest. But in order for us to worship, we have to be able to push aside all those things. We have to be able to focus our attention on God. And let me tell you, when we focus our attention on God, and when we see God for who He is, when we know God as the one who is looking at us with loving eyes, our hearts begin to change. Our worry meter goes down. Our anxiety barometer levels off, and we're able to find rest. And so our focus needs to be on God. Worship has to be our priority. He has gathered us for worship and He has enabled us to worship. Now, in the Ten Commandments, and it started already at creation because in Deuteronomy it tells us that we are to honor the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. That one out of 7 days we are to give to God. Now, you may ask yourself, is that really that important? Is that really necessary for us to give that one day every week to God? To set aside time where we can push aside all of the other things that our busy life involve, which are important, which are necessary, but to set them aside for a moment and focus our attention on God. God says, yes, it is necessary. It is something that is good for you. I take delight in your worship, but it is necessary for you in order for you to live before me as my children. Now, when we focus our attention on God, we're going to begin to see all the things that He has done. In this passage in Exodus, the Israelites saw the great power of God. For 430 years, they had lived oppressed by the Egyptian rulers, the Pharaoh. Anytime they tried to do anything other than what he said, they were suppressed, put down. Every time they tried to, Moses tried to make it possible for them to go in. What was the reason that Moses asked the people to be delivered so they could go and leave Egypt for a time? His request was that so that they could worship and praise their God. Moses and Pharaoh said no. Every time. And every time he said no, he lifted up and raised up the burden upon them. He made them produce more bricks. He made the work more difficult for them, and he took away any benefits that they might have to make it harder for them. Now, they saw what God was able to do to this Pharaoh, who had been over them for 430 years, how he was simply hurled into the sea, swallowed up by the waters that did not swallow them up but allowed them to walk on dry land. And so their focus was on God. If we see God's power at work in our lives in the same way, and do you not think that God works in powerful ways in our life? He does. Each and every day. When we realize that everything that happens is by God's hand and that nothing that happens isn't without God's involvement, we begin to see that without God's involvement, we are nothing, that we would not be able to function or live or breathe. But that requires trust. If we trust in Him, one of our responses of worship is trust and submission. And so the reason that we are able to come together on Sunday morning for worship, that we are to set aside our work and come into church and worship, set aside other things in our life that are important in order to worship, is because we say we are willing to submit. That we are trusting that God will take care of us. One of the great things about Sunday is that God said that you are to work 6 days out of the week. And the reason that we work is to provide for our families. But He said on the seventh day, you don't have to work. I'll take care of you. Trust me. That one day of work that you're not working is going to, you'll be fine. You'll still have a roof over your head. You'll still have food to eat. You'll still have clothes on your back. Trust me. Submit to my word. Submit to my authority. When we submit, we respond to God. Moses recalled all the things that God had done. He says in these first few verses, he says, "You are my strength. You are my song. You are my salvation. You are the story of my deliverance. You are majestic in holiness. You are awesome in glory. You are working your wonders and you are highly exalted." Now, Moses' response is one of what he has seen God doing in his life. Now, oftentimes, I will ask people in prayer, give me something to pray about, an item of praise, a God sighting. What are you praising God for what He has done in your life? Now, you would think that I would get, everybody's hands will be up. I have one. But inevitably, everybody's gone, I have to think about that. Really? Is that what God desires of us? That when we are asked, what is God doing in our life, that we have to say, let me think about it. And so you see that the reality of our life, even though we call ourselves Christians, is that we do not focus our attention on God enough. That we do not see what God is doing in our life, and so therefore we are not able to praise Him. We don't know what to respond to. The key is that God has to be the center of our life. Worship is an engagement with God on His terms, the way that He proposes, the way that He desires it. He gathers His community. He does it through the blood of Christ, by the work of the Holy Spirit, and He brings us together as in a fellowship, a community of believers, an organism of people that are here for the purpose of praise. And we do it because of our intense love. The scriptures are full of ways that we are to respond. Psalm 29, verse 2 says, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness." And in Revelation 4, the passage tells us that "You alone are worthy, O Lord our God, to receive glory and honor and power." You alone are worthy to receive our praise. And then Hebrews 11 says this, verse 6, "Without faith it is impossible to praise and please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe in Him and must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him." And then in Hebrews 10, "Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." Let us be an encouragement to one another. When we come together as worship, we come to praise God, but we also come to encourage each other in our fellowship, in living out as the body of Christ. Now, that worship comes in many different ways. Many churches do it in different ways. Many people do it in different ways. And we should not look down on some for the ways that they worship and expect others to worship the way that we worship. But worship can look many different ways. The words in Scripture that talk about worship are, here's three of them that I want to share with you. The first one is hallel. It's the word that alleluia comes from. Hallel means this. It's crazy, exuberant worship. It's people acting somewhat foolishly. People acting crazy, but doing in a way that they want to worship God. There are stories of it happening in Scripture with David dancing in the streets and Michael, his wife, saying, "You are acting like a fool." And he's saying, "I was praising God." And Michael saying, "But you were acting like a fool. You shouldn't be doing that. You're the king." And David said, "No, I may be the king, but I was worshiping my God." Now, because Michael did not want David to act that way, God put a curse on her and she never was able to have children. But God accepted the praise, the crazy worship of David. And so sometimes worship can get a little crazy. That's okay. As long as it's in praise to God. Another word is Shabbat. Shabbat means that worship and praise is loud. It's not quiet. Now, I get in trouble. I've always gotten in trouble in church. My mom used to poke me. My wife, if she were up here, she would be poking me. Don't sing so loud. The best part of being the preacher is when you're standing up here, you can sing as loud as you want because there's nobody around you that's going to care. God wants us to be loud with our worship, not be quiet. I mean, if you're at a ball game and you're rooting for your favorite team, if you're at a show and one of your friends is showing an animal and they win, do you go, "Yay, we're happy"? Or do you go crazy? Yes, we go crazy. We get excited. We stand up. We cheer. We're loud. Which brings us to the last word that I want to bring, and that is Shabbat is the loud word, and Shacha means to bow down. To bow down in reverence. To kneel before the Lord our Maker. To allow your body to get involved, not to be, "Praise you, Jesus," be stiff, but to allow your body to respond, to move about, to raise your hands, to kneel before the Lord, to bow your head, to put out your hands, to raise up your hands. It's a whole person experience to praise our God. And so when we sing, our responses that we look at and worship are singing, prayer, and offerings. When we sing, we're not singing to ourselves just so we sound nice. When we pray, we're not listening to the prayer to know what's going on, what's happening amongst the people in our church. Who's sick? Who went to the hospital? No, it's lifting these people up to God. And when we give our offerings, it's not a duty. It's not a bill. It's a response of praise. Thank you, Lord, for your work. And so we respond with joy to what God is doing and what he has done. The text talked about how God had delivered them from the enemy, how the enemy had been destroyed, how the enemy had been hurled into the sea and swallowed up by the waters. Now, who's our greatest enemy? Satan. The battle we fight is against the spiritual realms. Satan and his minions, the people that serve him. Our battle is against Satan and his work in the world. It's not against people. It's against Satan. It's a spiritual battle. And so when we praise God, we are exalting him for his defeating the enemy, for his destruction of Satan. We praise God because we do not have to fear Satan anymore. The Israelites, the Hebrew people, did not have to fear Pharaoh anymore. Pharaoh wasn't going to get on a boat and cross the Red Sea and chase them down because he was destroyed. Satan is not able to get us. Satan is not able to take us out of the clutch, out of the grip of God's hand. We are safe. Now, I was just talking to someone about this hailstorm that passed through our community a week or two ago, and how terrible it was, and all the windows were being broken, and it sounded terrible, and everything seemed to be breaking apart, and there was fear. People were afraid. What if these stones start coming right through the roof of our house? There was fear in the Israelites before they crossed the Red Sea, but now that fear was gone. We do not have to be afraid of Satan. He cannot destroy us. He cannot touch us. Oh, he can tempt us. He can lure us. But if we keep our focus on God, Satan has no power. No authority. And so our worship, our response is one of praise to God for what God has done in our lives. He is our salvation. He is our strength. He is our song. And so I invite you this morning, not only as we worship here, but as we go on in life, to keep your focus on God. In my own personal life, I can get distracted. And let me give you this testimony. Every Tuesday morning, I gather with 12 to 15 pastors from the Stephenville area. And we come with no agenda other than to focus on God, to reset our focus. And we start praying. And inevitably, every week, the prayers start flowing, and there's no end to them. We have to actually stop and say it's the time has come to a close. But it's always talking about what God is doing and what God promises to do. And because of this prayer time, I am able to enter my week, because I take Monday off, I am able to enter my week with a new focus, a reset focus. I'm once again calibrated properly with my focus and my attention and my heart set on God. And then my week goes much better. I hope that's the same for you. Because then your life will be an act of worship and praise to God. The things that you do will be a response to what God has shown to you. Moses and the Israelites had just been delivered. They had been delivered from slavery. They had been released from the oppression. They had found this new freedom. And they were excited. Of course they were excited. So the question I ask, who are we? Aren't we a people who have been delivered, who have been freed from slavery and sin, who have been found a new freedom in Christ? And should we not be excited about that? I go back to the story where the actor said, I bring fiction, but I present it as truth. Are we bringing truth, but presenting it as fiction? Are we speaking truth, but not really believing it? If we're unable to worship God, it's fiction. If we know God, our life will be one of worship. To know God is to worship Him. And so our response to God's wonderful work in our life is worship. Not only today and every Sunday, but every day of our life. Amen? Amen.